Welcome back. Making news this morning, Centrelink's workforce is struggling to keep up with demand, with millions of Aussies grappling with the cost of living crisis, stuck waiting longer on the phone for help.
Let's get today's take on this with journalist James Law and Nine Honey's Shelley Horton on the Gold Coast. Shelley, I'll go to you first. Then these new figures show that the average wait time has ballooned from 14 minutes to 20, and people need help.
Look, I understand that people need help, but I just do not think that this is a priority at the moment. Of course, cost of living is really impacting everyone. But what the opposition's doing is they're comparing our call time responses to pandemic times when, you know, half the nation was on JobKeeper or JobSeeker. So I really think that 14 to 20 minutes is not a big deal. Last week, I spent an hour on the phone to ANZ and 45 minutes on the phone to Telstra. If we're going to put more money into welfare, I don't want it to be for call centres. I want it to be for emergency housing, food banks, anything that is like a direct need, not someone spending a few more minutes online.
James, do you agree with Shelley on that?
No, I think that's a bit harsh from you, Shelley. I mean, I think that this shows a bit of a wider view of the way that we treat people on welfare. I mean, we know from the Robo-Debt Royal Commission that came out last week that people on welfare are often used as a political football. And I think this is further example of that where, you know, oh, it's fine to let them wait for another 10 minutes on the phone. Who cares about the people on welfare? So, I don't know, I feel like this shows the attitude we have towards people who are struggling.
So do you think it should be staffed more?
Yeah, I do. I think that they deserve to have the support. And, you know, as we know, in this cost of living crisis, these are the people who are going to do it the most tough. So let's help them out.
But, James, wouldn't you agree that rather than, you know, making call times shorter, actually getting physical food to people or helping them with their rent or getting emergency accommodation, that's more important?
Sure, but what I'm saying is this is a broader point about how we treat people who are on welfare, and I think that this is indicative of the attitude we have towards them.
I think you're both arguing in favour of people who need support, and that is a good thing.
Yeah. That's true.
We can agree on that.
That's true. Also making news this morning, there's a growing number of students choosing employment over further study due to the cost of living pressures. James, this is worrying because it could hamper their long-term career opportunities, but I feel like we're just pricing people out of being, you know, of higher education in this country, and it's got to stop.
Yeah, well, it's true. And, like, I remember when I was at uni, like, you didn't have a lot of money to play with. So if I had to cop a really big rental rise, which a lot of people are doing at the moment, and you've got the choice between going back to uni or TAFE and getting a job, I can understand why people are flooding towards getting paid work. So, yeah, there's a real problem here because, as you say, if they don't get these degrees, that's really going to have this big flow-on effect for the rest of their career and their earning potential.
Well, they'd look at other people's HEX bills mounting under inflation as well and worry about what the long-term ramifications are of that. A lot of courses, Shelley, you know, involve unpaid placements as well. What do you think of all this?
Look, it's really hard. I always encourage people to do further education if it's necessary for their career that they want to aspire to be in. But for me, I just don't think Australia is set up for unpaid internships. I think it's more likely that you do that overseas. I mean, when I was at university back in the dark ages at University of Queensland, I got a placement with ABC Radio for one day a week for my final year. That was unpaid. And now if you do that, you got double credit points and you got paid to do it. But the thing is, it's also how I learnt my skills to then be employed by the ABC afterwards. So it's a really tough thing. And I think it needs to be that you're following your passions, not you're deciding about, you know, what you should do according to your bank balance today, because this is the rest of your life you're talking about.
Of these university heads are getting, like, pulling 6-7 figures down a year just to run the place, I think something's seriously wrong in this country.
All right, guys, stay with us when we come back. When are you afraid of breaking up the old-fashioned way? Turns out Gen Z are.
And wipe away those tears. We're going to put a tearless onion to the test. Not the taste test, the eye test. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Turns out we're all a bunch of chickens. New study revealing 1 in 5 Aussies have broken up with their partner over text because they're cowards to avoid speaking on the phone. Man up!
Shelley and James are with us to discuss. Shell, this is brutal, don't you think?
I've done it.
Yeah.
Oh, me too, Shell.
Yes,
I am. Yeah, right? So, look, when I was between marriages, which does make me sound a bit like Elizabeth Taylor, but I was on the apps, and honestly, sometimes it's just easier to send the breakup text. And for me, I think we should embrace it as a new way of communicating and encourage people to actually be quite generous and kind with what they say when they break up, rather than trying to risk it in person where you stumble and then they talk you out of it and you're like, oh, okay, I guess we'll stay together. No, just do it, rip the band-aid
okay,
off.
But
it's fine.
Are there parameters here that, like, you're talking about someone you were, like, dating for a short period of time. If you've been
dating
with someone for, say,
term.
A year and you've moved in together, surely you can't.
Then you
break
just,
up on
then
text.
You just ghost them. You just move out.
No. You just lock yourself in the room. It's like, I'm not here.
No, that's exactly right. The difference is time, right? So if it's a matter of weeks, even maybe a matter of a few months, I think a text is acceptable.
What's the cutoff?
The cutoff, maybe 3 months.
Oh.
3 months.
I feel, because
right. It's the official rule now.
Yeah.
Oh, that's in print. That's official.
That's official. Okay. Well, especially because, like, young people now, I feel like a phone call is more confronting than the text, you know, because that's the way that people communicate now.
Yes.
And you can actually have time to make it quite thoughtful and respectful. So
sounds like you've broken up with a few people over text, James.
Some people have guilty conscience over here. All right, here's something else to shed a tear over. After decades of trials, Aussie growers have had a massive breakthrough and created the Teela's Onion.
About time.
Set to be rolled out in Woolies for a limited time. All right, sure, we're going to try this right now. I've got a... Wait, what have
You've
I got?
You've got an onion.
Dan, what have I got?
I've got a proper one? Well, we don't know.
We don't know.
We're going to cut and see what happens.
Okay,
let's
cool.
Let's see who cries.
Okay, so what do you think about this? Is this something that we've always needed, Shell?
Yes, this is like seedless watermelon. Like, this is just genius.
Seedless
watermelon.
If you
have a look, this is how I actually cut my onions.
How do you cut
look
it?
Look at the screen,
with sunglasses?
Guys. No, goggles.
Go back
goggles.
To Shell.
There she is.
Swimming goggles.
Oh, look at you.
It works. It
it's
works.
A good look.
You do not cry when you've got these on. You just have a lot of shame from wearing them. Oh, so, how are you guys going?
I'm getting some strength coming from this.
Are you? How are you going over there?
Well, I'm getting...
My eyes are fine.
Put your face closer.
Smell, the smell of mine is... I think I might... What have I got?
I don't know.
Are
I think
you crying
you, I think I've got it.
Yeah. You've got the cry.
I think I've
You've
got... Because my eyes are getting a bit watery.
You're a big chicken.
I'm not a big chicken. You're a big chicken.
You're a big chicken.
Just do it by text, for goodness sake. I definitely... So, can you not smell anything?
I can smell full
Does
onion
it smell like onion? Because mine's really whiffy.
But I'm not crying, and I cry the moment I open onion.
Oh, really? Yeah. The moment I open onion.
Yeah.
James, would this help you?
Yeah, I had to make a bolognese the other day and
just,
like,
give it a bit of a Tony Abbott. Have a go at it. Just have
Should
a
no.
Have a bit of
no,
a chooser.
No.
Just for TV.
Yes, for telly. Have a go at it. Go on. There it goes. There's Tony. There's Tone. Ready? Look at everyone laughing at him
now
too.
Now let's do a
go.
This is for you, Tone.
One for the country.
You know who likes that as well? Miriam Margolyes always carries an onion around.
She
her.
Does.
She does. I wonder what she would think
what?
Of all this.
I wondered
she
if
carries an onion in her purse, Shelley. You're right over my shoulder.
That is
so
strange.
She always
like
carries
the old
an
man
and she chews into it all the time. Great vitamin C.
Well, this has been a great experiment.
Wow.
And now my hands smell like onions.
Yes.
Happy to be here on the Gold Coast.
It smells like Italian here.
Very good.
Guys, thank you both so much for being here.
I think they'll be breaking up with you.
By the way, can you send this onion back? Look at Wayne. I don't think you get a
Oh, that's disgusting.
No, I dropped it.
Oh, no wonder you were crying.
Oh, God, sorry.
Coming up, a country music star.